after we wrote Freakonomics and I began to be in demand for speaking, the lecture agency that signed me up was horrified about what I was going to do on stage. And so they called a very fancy speaking consultant and flew this guy from California to Chicago to come and meet with me. And so he comes in my office and he said, I've looked at your tapes and the bad news is that we could work for a year intensively and I think I could make you an average business speaker because you do every single thing wrong. And I thought, that's not a good start to my speaking career. He said, but there's one really strange thing, which is that I've watched the tapes of you, and even though you do everything wrong, audiences kind of like you. And I have just three words of advice, three pieces of advice for you. And the first one was, you're never allowed to wear a tie. He said, the only thing you have going for you is authenticity. And as soon as you put on a tie, you become completely fake. He said, the other thing is, I don't ever want you to stand behind a podium. Because when you're behind a podium, you're protected from the audience. And I think the reason the audience likes you is because you're so vulnerable as a speaker and you're so bumbling that the audience needs to see you out there naked to really feel what you're like. And so the great news was, I know how to be myself. So I said, okay, good, I'll just try to be myself. And so I've, for the last 5 or 10 years, honed a fake authenticity to be who I am on stage. What I think makes for good storytelling, authenticity is 85% of it. If you think in terms of marketing, advertising, so much when I talk to advertising agencies, they do focus groups. They ask people why they like the product or what they want to buy. I think that's totally wrong. What makes things special is what people don't know that they need. I mean, I think about email. So when email came around, I couldn't imagine why I would ever want email. I was slow to adopt. I couldn't envision it. Okay, but then once I got it, it opened up an entire world to me. And that's true of almost all new technologies. And I think humans are so limited in the way we think about tomorrow that I think, to me, that's what storytelling is. It's helping people see things they've never imagined before. The interesting things you do with data almost always involve taking two disparate data sets and putting them together. And most companies have no ability to do that. They have systems that don't allow them to actually let their data speak to each other. When I work with companies, it's almost always what's interesting about data is doing something they were never designed to do. So the data were designed to keep track of what customers were buying, but what's interesting is actually say to see, well, what didn't they buy? What did they start to buy and then never finish buying? So I really believe that for companies, finding ways to create just a big pile of data that talks to each other and have it be open, because you never know who's going to have the ideas. I mean, it's Apple's idea, right? Apple said, well, we don't have all the good ideas about what the apps are, so let's just let anyone come in and make apps. And I think that's often right, that outsiders, customers, developers can know so much more about what the world wants than executives at a company. And that's a fundamental change in the way we do business.